Hello everybody, welcome to our YouTube channel Jai Shri Chavaji. Today we shall continue to see the part 18 of the book Rich Dad Poor Dad written by Robert Kiyosaki. Chapter 5, Lesson 5, The Rich Invent Money continues. The stock plays I personally invested in were extremely high risk for most people and absolutely not recommended. I have been playing that game since 1979 and have paid more than my share in dues. But if you will reread why investments such as these are high risk for most people, you may be able to set your life up differently so that the ability to take $25,000 and turn it into $1 million in a year is low risk for you. As stated earlier, nothing I have written is a recommendation. It is only used as an example of what is simple and possible. What I do is small potatoes in the grand scheme of things. Yet, for the average individual, a passive income of more than $100,000 a year is nice and not hard to achieve. Depending on the market and how smart you are, it could be done in 5 to 10 years. If you keep your living expenses modest, $100,000 coming in as additional income is pleasant regardless of whether you work. You can work if you like or take time off if you choose and use the government tax system in your favor rather than against you. My personal basis is real estate. I love real estate because it's stable and slow moving. I keep the base solid. The cash flow is fairly steady and, if properly managed, has a good chance of increasing in value. The beauty of a solid base of real estate is that it allows me to take greater risk as I do with speculative stocks. If I make great profits in the stock market, I pay my capital gains tax on the gain and then reinvest what's left in real estate, again further securing my asset foundation. A last word on real estate. I have traveled all over the world and taught investing. In every city, I hear people say you cannot buy real estate cheap. This is not my experience. Or I would say that is not my experience. Even in New York or Tokyo, or just on the outskirts of the city, prime bargains are overlooked by most people. In Singapore, with their high real estate prices, there are still bargains to be found within a short driving distance. So, whenever I hear someone say, "You can't do that here," pointing at me, I remind them that maybe the real statement is, "I don't know how to do that here yet." Great opportunities are not seen with your eyes. They are seen with your mind. Most people never get wealthy simply because they are not trained financially to recognize opportunities right in front of them. I'm often asked, how do I start? In the final chapter of this book, I offer 10 steps that I followed on the road to my financial freedom. But always remember to have fun. When you learn the rules and the vocabulary of investing and begin to build your asset column, I think you'll find that it's a fun game as you have ever played. Sometimes you win and sometimes you learn, but have fun. Most people never win because they are more afraid of losing. That is why I found school so silly. In school, we learn that mistakes are bad and we are punished for making them. Yet, if you look at the way humans are designed to learn, we learn by making mistakes. We learn to walk by falling down. If we never fell down, we would never walk. The same is true for learning to ride a bike. I still have scars on my knees, but today I can ride a bike without thinking. The same is true for getting rich. Unfortunately, the main reason most people are not rich is because they are terrified of losing. Winners are not afraid of losing, but losers are. Failure is a part of the process of success. People who avoid failure also avoid success. I look at money much like my game of tennis. I play hard, make mistakes, correct, make more mistakes, correct, and get better. If I lose the game, I reach across the net, shake my opponent's hand, smile, and say, "See you next Saturday." There are two kinds of investors. The first and most common type is a person who buys a packaged investment. They call a retail outlet, such as a real estate company, a stock broker, or a financial planner, and they buy something. It could be a mutual fund, a REIT, a stock, or a bond. It is a clean and simple way of investing. An analogy would be a shopper who goes to a computer store and buys a computer right off the shelf. The second type is an investor who creates investments. This investor usually assembles a deal in the same way a person who buys components builds a computer. I do not know the first thing about putting components of a computer together, but I do know how to put pieces of opportunities together, or know people who know how. It is this second type of investor who is the more professional investor. Sometimes it may take years for all the pieces to come together, and sometimes they never do. It's this second type of investor that my rich dad encouraged me to be. It is important to learn how to put the pieces together, because that is where the huge wins reside, and sometimes huge losses if the tide goes against you. If you want to be the second type of investor, you need to develop three main skills. Skill number one, find an opportunity that everyone else missed. You see with your mind what others miss with their eyes. For example, a friend bought this rundown old house. It was spooky to look at. Everyone wondered why he bought it. What he saw that we did not was the house came with four extra empty lots. He discovered that after going to the title company. After buying the house, he tore the house down and sold the five lots to a builder for three times what he paid for the entire package. He made $75,000 for 2 months of work. It is not a lot of money, but it sure beats minimum wage, and it's not technically difficult. Point number two, raise money. The average person only goes to the bank. This second type of investor needs to know how to raise capital, and there are many ways that don't require a bank. To get started, I learned how to buy houses with the bank. It was the learned skill of raising money more than the houses themselves that was priceless. Although often I hear people say, "The bank won't lend me money," or "I don't have the money to buy it." If you want to be a type 2 investor, you need to learn how to do that, which stops most people. In other words, a majority of people let their lack of money stop them from making a deal. If you can avoid that obstacle, you will be millions ahead of those who don't learn those skills. There have been many times I have bought a house, a stock, or an apartment building without a penny in the bank. I once bought an apartment house for $1.2 million. I did what is called tying it up with a written contract between seller and buyer. I then raised the $100,000 deposit, which bought me 90 days to raise the rest of the money. Why did I do it? Simply because I knew it was worth $2 million. I never raised the money. Instead, the person who put up the $100,000 gave me $50,000 for finding the deal, took over my position, and I walked away. Total working time was 3 days. Again, it's what you know more than what you buy. Investing is not buying, it's more a case of knowing. Point number three, organize smart people. Intelligent people are those who work with or hire a person who is more intelligent than they are. When you need advice, make sure you choose your advisor wisely. There is a lot to learn, but the rewards can be astronomical. If you do not want to learn those skills, then being a type 1 investor is highly recommended. It is what you know that is your greatest wealth. It is what you do not know that is your greatest risk. There is always risk, so learn to manage risk instead of avoiding it. Chapter 6, Lesson 6, Work to Learn, Don't Work for Money. Job security meant everything to my educated dad. Learning meant everything to my rich dad. A few years ago, I granted an interview with a newspaper in Singapore. The young female reporter was on time and the interview got underway immediately. We sat in the lobby of a luxurious hotel, sipping coffee and discussing the purpose of my visit to Singapore. I was to share the platform with Zig Ziglar. He was speaking on motivation and I was speaking on the secrets of the rich. "Someday I would like to be a best-selling author like you," she said. I had seen some of the articles she had written for the paper and I was impressed. She had a tough, clear style of writing. Her articles held a reader's interest. "You have a great style," I said in reply. "What holds you back from achieving your dream?" "My work does not seem to go anywhere," she said quietly. "Everyone says that my novels are excellent, but nothing happens. So I keep my job with the paper. At least it pays the bills. Do you have any suggestions?" "Yes, I do," I said brightly. "A friend of mine here in Singapore runs a school that trains people to sell. He runs sales training courses for many of the top corporations here in Singapore, and I think attending one of his courses would greatly enhance your career." She stiffened. "Are you saying I should go to a school to learn to sell?" I nodded. "You aren't serious, are you?" Again, I nodded. "What is wrong with that?" I was now backpedaling. She was offended by something, and now I was wishing I had not said anything. In my attempt to be helpful, I found myself defending my suggestion. "I have a master's degree in English literature. Why would I go to school to learn to be a salesperson? I am a professional. I went to school to be trained in a profession, so I would not have to be a salesperson. I hate salespeople. All they want is money. So tell me, why should I study sales?" She was packing her briefcase. The interview was over. On the coffee table sat a copy of an earlier best-selling book I wrote. I picked it up as well as the notes she had jotted down on her legal pad. "Do you see this?" I said, pointing to her notes. She looked down at her notes. "What?" she said, confused. Again, I pointed deliberately to her notes. On her pad, she had written, "Robert Kiyosaki, best-selling author." "It says best-selling author, not best writing author," I said quietly. Her eyes widened. "I'm a terrible writer," I said. "You are a great writer. I went to sales school. You have a master's degree. Put them together and you get a best-selling author and a best writing author." Anger flared from her eyes. "I'll never stoop so low as to learn how to sell. People like you have no business writing. I'm a professionally trained writer and you are a salesman. It is not fair," she fumed. She put the rest of her notes away and hurried out through the large glass doors into the humid Singapore morning. At least she gave me a fair and favorable write-up the next morning. The world is filled with smart, talented, educated and gifted people. We meet them every day. They are all around us. A few days ago, my car was not running well. I pulled into a garage and the young mechanic had it fixed in just a few minutes. He knew what was wrong by simply listening to the engine. I was amazed. I'm constantly shocked at how little talented people earn. I have met brilliant, highly educated people who earn less than $20,000 a year. A business consultant who specializes in the medical trade was telling me how many doctors, dentists, and chiropractors struggle financially. All this time, I thought that when they graduated, the dollars would pour in. It was this business consultant who gave me the phrase, "They are one skill away from great wealth." Okay, all, let's end up for today. We shall continue to see how Robert justifies the phrase, "They are one skill away from the great wealth." Thank you for continuously listening to our recordings. Have a wonderful day.